Hey everybody, how's it? Aloha. The Smashing Pumpkins. To me personally, in the soundtrack of my life, though I only listened to a couple of their songs, what they mean to me is how I watch their music affect my nephew during a very challenging part of his life. And he always ran and listened to the Smashing Pumpkins, and he would be in a great mood, and he'd just get on with it. And I was just, that's where Smashing Pumpkin lives for me, is that, though I did hear a couple of their songs when they first came out, but you know, my head was kind of in a whole different section of music, you know, as doing the composer stuff I was doing for media. Nonetheless, Cherub Rock was suggested to me. And so I look forward to this, and when I'm done with this, I'm going to call up my nephew and say, hey, check this out. I think it'll bring back good memories for the both of us. I want to thank everybody who's bought me a cup of coffee, knowing that my channel is still not monetized. And I don't think I ever will, but that'll be a whole different video. The link for the cup of coffee, should you see fit, is below. So will be the links. For Spotify, Smashing Pumpkin merch and stuff like that. This video also without me yammering over it. So thanks again for all the support, all the suggestions. And then after this, please list other Smashing Pumpkin songs you want me to hang out with you and enjoy and rinse. So here we go, Smashing Pumpkins, Cherub Rock. All right. Okay, I gotta stop right there, and I'm the chord changes that they're playing is they've been used in many different songs, and what I mean by that is that there's certain patterns that songs have, and you can say, hey, that kind of sounds a little bit. There's a little familiarity with it, but what's not familiar about it, and what makes this uniquely Smashing Pumpkins, is the riff that they pulled out of those chord changes. And there's that ominous kind of pedaled note that, even though they're playing their riff, I think the note is da da dun da 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 da, but that note right there is pedaled through, or that's the root of what they're playing in that. That is something that just kind of pulls you from here and keeps you locked in. Obviously the rhythm pattern, you know, the whole delivery of getting you set in there, obviously with that just guitar that was opening up, and then the drum, you know, just on the snare, kind of gives you this kind of anthem-y kind of vibe, and then it locks you right into a beat, kind of like a We Will Rock You kind of vibe. Nothing, not complex, but powerful enough to get you locked into it. Then, when I heard him sing, I remembered now what it was about Smashing Pumpkins that I found incredibly powerful, was the fact that this was a rock band, be it whatever subgenre as well. They were listening, but his voice is so unique. In of itself, it is a hook, the sound of his voice. I don't listen to the lyrics when I do, you know, these breakdowns and stuff. And, you know, the lead singer is an instrument to me. And the dichotomy or the separation in him as a performer and his passion and his soul with what he's singing or how he's performing his melody compared to the power and the straight structure of the rock behind it is, to me, a secondary hook to the main hook. And what I mean by the main hook is that phrase, for those of you who are just the pure listener, that's why I do this. I don't do this for musicians. This isn't theoretical, obviously. Is that hook is that one phrase that'll repeat itself once, twice, maybe three times in a song, so you become familiar with, in most cases, it's the title of the song. But it's his voice that put me over the top in going, this is what it was all about. So let's march on. All right. All right, something else I want to bring up really quick. The bass playing is what is now, because I'm a composer and I'm listening to different levels and stuff like this. The bass playing, I spent just this last passage fully focusing on. And remember I was telling you about that pedaled note, that one note that lasts? When the guitar is, you know, doing that pattern. Listen to the bass. That bass is staying on that one note that pedals all the way through it and is giving it that drive. To me, that's where I feel the attachment to the whole rhythm section, the whole rhythmic arrangement and composition of that is actually now has become the bass for me. So when you go back and listen to this, even from the beginning, listen to the bass. I mean, really, I don't mean so focus on it, but I mean just acknowledge its work, because it's an extremely important part of the composition to me. But, you know, the bass doesn't necessarily get a lot of love, you know, in out front, stage, stuff like that, necessarily, I'm just saying. But it is the unsung hero a lot of times that just becomes part of it, and the audience at large and the pure listener at large, they just dig with it. But it's, you know, it's that thing. It's that John Paul Jones thing. It's that Geddy Lee thing. It's that Sting thing where the bass has, you know, an extremely powerful position and arrangement in songs that a lot of times don't really get any real focus, but I hear it, I feel it. All right, here we go. We'll be right back. I like that ending. You know, I'm going back to the bass really quick on this again. When he's singing Let Me Out and stuff, listen to what the bass is doing and how it's walking around and phrasing all the way through it while still the power of the, you know, the rhythm guitar and the riff and the drums are still pressing forward. He's very melodic back there in his bass playing. And another thing is, because I don't remember who plays what. I don't know who was the solo guitar player in this, but I loved every bit of the nuances in that solo. The bending of the strings until it was just string noise against fret. And there's so much about that human element sometimes that I sometimes get lost in, especially on this channel. I listen to so many amazing bands with such unbelievably talented musicians and stuff. And when they do all their heavy solos, you know, the technicality of it and stuff is still amazing and mind-numbing, but there's something to be said about that one or two or three notes that just ring out in a melodic solo, and it doesn't have speed, and it could be just a bend, or it could be, you know, fret noise with a pick, you know, going into it and stuff. And I really, really, really dug it. Is it Billy that Corrigan that does the lead? Anyhow, thanks for reminding me. You know, somebody dropped this in a comment. I'm so stoked. Before you dig, though, I'm curious, when this song is fairly old, I believe. So where is this in the soundtrack of your life? If you're still here and you're listening, where was this in your soundtrack of life? What great thing was happening in your life or not, or challenging when you heard this the very first time? And if you're still here, type in the comments, I'm still here too. That's kind of fun. Thank you so much for the support. I'm taking a break soon, so I'm trying to jam up as many as I can. The link for all of their music will be below. The link for the cup of coffee, so you see fit, will be below. And it's not just for a cup of coffee. It also helps me what I do with the kids and ventriloquism and stuff. And that link's down there too if you want to take a peek at that. So if you're still here, type in, I'm still here. All right.